Today's spoiler video is brought to you by Card Kingdom. Use the link below to pre-order your cards today. Hello everyone, it's Seth, probably better known as Saffron Olive, and it's time for our final daily dose of Jumpstart Historic Horizon spoilers. So, we got our last new card today. We got some sweet reprints, even some surprising reprints. So, I think there might be still a person or two that has previews left, but there's no new cards left. By my count. So we're going to wrap things up today. Also, want to let you know a little bit about the future of this set. So even though we're done with spoilers, that doesn't mean we're done with this set. There's going to be a ton of gameplay. There's a huge list of historic decks I want to build. So expect a lot of new historic decks on stream and video after the set releases August 12th. Also, probably do some sort of like crafting tier list or something to talk about where you should spend your wild cards if you're going to try to invest in this set on Magic Arena. Also, of course, if you want to see the latest previews, you can check them all out over at mtgpreviews.com. But let's talk the rest of the cards from Jumpstart Historic Horizons on our last new card, Benelish Partisan. So a 2-mana 1/2 with lifelink. Whenever you cycle another card, you can pay 1 and a white. If you do, you return it from your graveyard to the battlefield tapped, and it perpetually gets +1/+0, and it has cycling of 1 and a white. So Benelish Partisan, if it's gonna work, I think it's most likely gonna work in cycling. And cycling is kind of a legitimate archetype in historic. It's not super top tier, but we have seen it played competitively. We have seen it be pretty good. Is it possible that Benelish Partisan will fit in this deck? The answer is maybe. So on one hand, if you look at the cycling deck, it really values cards that cycle for a single mana. Benelish Partisan, it is 2 mana, including colored mana, to cycle. In fact, the only cards in the cycling deck that cost more than one to cycle are Hollowind and Sweltering Suns, and these are the cycling cards that are really in your deck to cast. Like, cycling is an upside. There are times when you cycle them, but these are really in your deck to be played as actual spells rather than cycled away. So being 2 mana is a bit of a drawback for Benelish Partisan. On the other hand, we've seen some cycling decks playing things like Reptilian Reflection to try to get around opposing removal, try to get around opponent's sweepers, which are really, really good against the cycling deck. Could Benelish Partisan maybe fill that role? Like, Reptilian Reflection doesn't have cycling at all. Benelish Partisan is resilient to removal. Like, it dies, you can cycle, you can get it back, it's going to be even bigger. It dies, you can cycle, you get it back, it's going to be even bigger. So it is a really interesting card for slower, grindier matchups. So I could see it having a home in the deck. I don't think this is going to, like, revolutionize the deck, but it does go a long way towards solving some of the deck's problems with fighting through removal, and it does it being attached to a cycling card, which is nice because you want as many cycling cards as possible to power up your Zenith Flares and whatnot. So as I mentioned, resilient to a lot of removal. Your opponent Rasps, you cycle a random card, it comes back, or Fatal Push or Lightning Helix. That said, there is exile-based removal in Historic. Declaration of Stone Anger, the God Scorching Dragonfire, Skyclave Apparition. These are all heavily played cards in the format, so, and those are permanent answers to Benelish Partisan, which is a bit of a drawback. Still, I think there's a decent chance that this shows up in the cycling list. Obviously, if you just cast it, it's bad. A 2-mana 1/2, not good. If you cycle it and get it back, it's a 2/2 that I guess kind of costs you 4 mana, but I don't think you can really count the cycling cost. And that's okay. It gets much more exciting in the late game when it dies a couple times and keeps coming back. And we have seen these grindy graveyard cards like Skyclave Shade or Dreadwander or Gutterbones, which they aren't all that efficient either. Like, sure, Benelish Partisan, it's 2 mana to get back and you gotta cycle that dirt. But Skyclave Shade is what? 2 mana to recast from your graveyard. Dreadwander costs 3 mana to get back. Gutterbones cost 2 mana to get back, and these are all legitimate staples in the historic format in the mono black deck. So I think that Benelish Partisan, even though it's not super efficient, I think that its ability to fight through removal, keep coming back into play, and having a natural fit in the cycling deck makes it a relatively exciting card. So I think this definitely has a home in the cycling deck, and while much less likely, I don't think it's completely impossible that it could show up in some sort of generic deck as well, like those mono black cards, where if you can fit a reasonable amount of cycling stuff, cycling lands or whatever in your deck that you can get this back, it's actually like a pretty nice resilient threat coming back from the graveyard. So not a busted card by any means, but probably on the playable list as far as the new cards from Historic Horizons. We also got some really big reprints: Sevulin of Sea and Sky and Master of the Pearl Trident, two incredibly powerful merfolk. And merfolk are a tribe that they've been around in Historic forever. They're actually one of the intro pack tribes, or were in the past, and they have always seen some amount of play in the format, but they've never really been good in the format. They just haven't quite gotten there. But I think these new cards might be changing that. Now that we have Master of Pearl Trident, we have that to go along with Merfolk Mistbinder and Meryl Reijery to give the deck three different really strong modern level lords. And that's a lot of lords in your tribal deck. Like, merfolk are going to get really big really fast. The only downside of Master of the Pearl Trident is I couldn't find a single card in the Historic format that can turn your opponent's stuff into an island. One of the tricks in modern merfolk is you play Lord of Atlantis, you play Master of the Pearl Trident, use Spreading Seas or Tide Shaper or Seas Climb, whatever, to give your opponent an island, and then all of a sudden your entire team is unblockable. I don't think it's possible to do that yet in Historic, so the island walk aspect of Master of the Pearl Trident, it's going to be matchup dependent. If you run into a blue deck, your team's just going to be unblockable, and it's insane. But if you're not playing against a blue deck, you can't really force your opponent to get an island in the format, at least as far as I could find. But that's not a deal breaker. I mean, even without island walk, which I think in Historic is more of like an upside, a fringe upside, rather than a build around, even without that, it's a 2-mana lord on tribe. It's a 2/2. Like, it's a really good card, even if you're only island walking some percentage of the time, rather than every game like in modern. As far as Sevulin, this card's insane. Like, this card has immediately become a 4 of in modern merfolk, to the point where modern merfolk used to be a Loris deck, and they dropped Loris to play Sevulin. Like, that's how insane this card is. A 3-mana 3/4, obviously strong stats, indestructible most of the time in a merfolk deck, drawing you cards and protecting your other merfolk. It's bonkers. It's absolutely insane. And in Historic, it's arguably even better because there's no like Path to Exile running around. Sure, we talked about some of the exile based removal that exists. It is there, but it's not as heavily played as it is in modern, where Path to Exile is a staple. So I think if you mash these two cards together, merfolk might have a shot to actually be legit in the format. It's like an Aether Vial away from being modern merfolk. And even without Aether Vial, I think that just casting your merfolk is going to be pretty scary thanks to these new additions. So actually kind of excited to see if merfolk can make the rise from new player experience intro deck type of tribe to legitimate competitive tribe. If they do, it's probably going to be because of the power of Sevulin and also Master of Pearl Trident. We also got Blade Spicer, just a fun card, a 3-mana 1/1 that when it comes into play, you make a 3/3 golem, and it gives your golems first strike. I don't think we're building golem tribal or anything in Historic. However, Blade Spicer, really good with blink effects, and now, thanks to Jumpstart Historic Horizons, we got Restoration Angel, best friends with Blade Spicer. That's an old standard trick from like 10 years ago. Turn 3 Blade Spicer, turn 4 Resto, blink it. You have two 3/3 golems. That's a lot of power. We also have Ephemerate, so maybe some sort of straight up blink shell can develop. If you're flickering this every turn, that's adding a lot of power to the battlefield on a relatively uncurved body. Also, Panharmonicon, cough. It does work well with Panharmonicon. I also think that it could potentially just be a 3-drop for Mono White Aggro. Like, we've seen Mono White Aggro be a deck in the format. Right now, they're playing Skyclave Aberration, Elite Spellbinder, Archon of Emyria as their 3-drops. I don't think you're going to drop Skyclave. That card's insane. I don't think you're going to drop Spellbinder. That's also very good and it flies. But I could see an argument, at least in some decks, in some metas, that Blade Spicer might just be better than Archon of Emyria. Like, Archon of Emyria, the taxing effect is nice, but Blade Spicer is adding more power to the battlefield, and if you have some Restoration Angels or other synergies to take advantage of it, then it goes up in value even more. Like, if you can get two golems out of this, that is a lot of value for a 3-drop. So Blade Spicer, it's a sweet card. I've always liked this card, and I'm excited to have it in Historic. Whether or not it actually does a ton, that remains to be seen, but I think blink decks are going to use it for sure, and Mono White may be going to use Blade Spicer as well. We also got King of the Pride, and oh boy, is this a good one. 3-mana, 2/1 Cat Lord, but it's like a double Cat Lord. Your other cats get plus 2+1. And cats, that's another tribe that hasn't really been there. We've played them in multiple formats, and they're a tribe that always overperforms. Every time we play cats, they do better than we think they're going to do. They've never become a legit top-tier tribe, but now, thanks to King of the Pride, Historic might be the format for that. If you think about what cats in Historic have access to now, it is maybe the most impressive Lord package in the entire format. You have King of the Pride to go along with Kahira, which if you're playing Cat Tribal can be your companion, to go along with Feline Sovereign, to go along with Regal Caracal. That means like more than half of the creatures in your deck can just straight up be lords. You can also replace Caracal perhaps with Galactic Company and have three mana cat lords that you can hit with Coco. So there's definitely a lot of potential here. Like cats have way more lords than Merfolk even. Merfolk is like the most iconic lord tribe probably in Magic. Cats, I think, actually just best them in Historic, and they might actually be more powerful. And you get to back up the lords with some really strong utility spells. We mentioned Galactic Company as a possibility, but like Pride Sovereign, insane. In a cat deck, it's like a 3-mana 8-8 or something that makes more cats. Azika's Chariot, another exciting new addition. Like, normally you just play it as a generic good spell in Standard, but it goes up in value in cats because it makes 2 cat tokens, and you can copy all the tokens that your other cats makes if you turn it on. So I think that cats in Historic actually have a chance to be pretty legitimate, in large part because King of the Pride is really insane for a 3-mana lord. That extra +1 to power is a huge deal. They're getting that critical mass of lords and have a really solid curve, so we'll have to see how it all shakes out, but I actually think that cats, they could be a real deck in Historic now too. We also got MH2 Uncommon Tireless Provisioner, which is a card that's done a little bit of work in Modern. Just when you make a land drop, you get a food or a treasure token. In Historic, we don't actually have Tireless Tracker, which for the most part's probably a better Tireless Provisioner, but we don't have that in Historic, so maybe Tireless Provisioner can fill that role. Although, a clue token, generally more valuable than a food or a treasure. That said, I still think that Tireless Provisioner could have a home in the format. The drawback is, in Modern, it is mostly seen play in like Glimpse of Tomorrow, Warp World style combo decks. We also don't have those cards in Historic at this point, so you'd have to play it fairly, but it is cheap enough to get hit by Galactic Company, so that's one thing it has going for it. And making a food, while in a generic sense isn't as good as making a clue, in certain decks can be really strong. Like one of the best decks in Historic right now is the Cauldron Familiar Sacrifice deck, which is built around food tokens. Trail of Crumbs is its big engine piece. Maybe you just play Tireless Provisioner as an extra resource generator to fuel your Trail of Grubs and your Witches Ovens and your Cauldron's Familiars and your Corvolds. So Tireless Provisioner, I don't think this is going to like revolutionize Historic or anything, but it is an interesting card that has a chance to see play. We also got some more vampire support. Cordial Vampire, just a 2-mana 1/1 that when it or one of your creatures dies, you get to put a counter on each vampire you control. So vampires are a deck in Historic, driven mostly by Sorin, Imperious Bloodlord, which happens to sacrifice a creature to Lightning Helix, which will then trigger your Cordial Vampire, put counters on your team, which seems like it could be pretty interesting. On the other hand, the typical vampire deck does have a ton of sac fodder. Like, you do sacrifice stuff to Sorin on occasion, but you're often putting big vampires into play with Sorin. You could build a straight up sack base deck. You got like Silver Smoke Ghoul. You gain the 3 life with Sorin, sacrifice it, they all come back into play on your end step, you're triggering Cordial Vampire, or like Yahani happens to be an Aetherborn Vampire, or Immerstrom Predator. So maybe we get some sort of like aristocrat style vampire deck. I'm not sure that I would just slot Cordial Vampire into the straightforward top tier, or well, tier 3, whatever the known version of vampires in Historic. But I do think it's strong enough to power a vampire deck in Historic. And also worth mentioning, we know we're getting a ton more vampires soon. Like, we're getting 2 Innistrad sets. We're going to get the Midnight Hunt Werewolf set. That's going to be spoiled in, what, another couple of weeks? We'll enter spoiler season. But then after that, in November, we're getting a vampire theme set. So this could also be a plant for the future. Maybe it doesn't make a ton of sense right now. Maybe it doesn't have a home in traditional vampires in Historic right now. But once we get a whole set, based around vampires. It could be that Cordial Vampire is like one of the best cards from Jumpstart Historic Rises, and vampires are like super legit amazing in Historic. So anyway, that brings us to the end of our daily Jumpstart Historic Rises spoilers for today. So let me know what you think. Let me know what you think of the reprints, the new cards. Now that you've seen the whole set, what do you think about this set? Are you excited? Are you dreading it? What deck do you want to build first? Or do you just not care? Do you not play Historic? You don't play Arena and you want to see more Modern and Legacy and Standard? Give me your thoughts in the comments. And as I mentioned before, tons of Historic stuff going to be coming up because there's a ton of decks that I want to build with these new cards. So gotta wait a little bit until August 12th for the set to release, but once the set comes out, expect lots of sweet new Historic stuff and probably some sort of crafting video later this week too. So thanks for watching this spoiler season. I hope you all enjoyed it, and I will be back, what, a couple of weeks from now with Innistrad Midnight Hunt spoilers. Don't know the exact start date. It's gotta be the end of August sometime. Thanks again for watching, and yeah, have an amazing day, and I will talk to you soon. Thanks for watching the video. If you enjoyed it, help us out by clicking that like button down below. And to keep up on all the latest and greatest, click that subscribe button. And don't forget to hit that bell icon to get alerts whenever we have new videos. And if you want to, check out some of our other sweet videos here and here.